Good afternoon and a very warm welcome to you as we join together for our annual service where we think about the seven words that the gospel writers place on the mouth of Jesus as he has the moment of his passion. I'm delighted to welcome all of you and all who are joining us online too. We'll have seven different meditations on these words of Jesus given by the different ministers in the parish grouping, which takes in both the city centre, the west end of Aberdeen, and also the Riverside churches. And we're glad to welcome everyone. We join together in hymn 553, "Just as I am, without one plea." Friends, let us pray. Man of sorrows, yet Son of God, we gather on this day of your passion to remember your love, a love spent, a love freely given, a love exhausted for the needs of humanity, and for the sake of God's people. We remember those words of wisdom, those cries of despair, even still those thoughts of others uttered from that cross, words which continue to give life to us and to all of humanity. Lord Jesus, be with us. You do not strike back with revenge against your enemies as they ridiculed and as they crucified you. Somehow, O Lord, you prayed for their forgiveness. We do not find forgiveness comes easy to us. It may not have come easy to you, and yet you forgave. Lord, on this day of your passion, forgive us our sin and strengthen us, heal us, support us as we seek to be people who can somehow forgive others. And when the world and others tear down relationships, help us to be those who seek to rebuild them, restore them, and bring healing to creation. Through Christ, and in his name we pray. Amen. We read from Colossians, reading in chapter 3 from verse 12. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other, just as the Lord has forgiven you. So you must also forgive. Above all else, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in the one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another with wisdom. And with gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. And in Luke's Gospel, we read at chapter 23 from verse 26. As they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country, and they laid the cross upon him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A great number of the people followed him, and among them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For the days are surely coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?" Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. Thanks be to God for his word. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. These words which Luke puts on Jesus' lips at the height of his agony and pain on the cross may seem strange at first. Immediately after being crucified, nailed, and hanging on a wooden beam, these are the first words that Luke has Jesus say. How, might we ask, can Luke portray Jesus as saying such words of forgiveness at such an excruciating and painful moment in time? Indeed, to call these words of forgiveness doesn't really do them justice. They are astonishing. They are words that are simply beyond belief. But perhaps these words of forgiveness are not so surprising if we take a look at the whole of Jesus' life as portrayed in Luke's Gospel. For in Luke's Gospel, Jesus is the one who forever forgives. And that forgiveness is displayed in his life and his teaching. Forgiveness is a recurrent theme in Luke's Gospel. So in that context, Christ's words may not be such a shock. Jesus is, for Luke, the living representative of the God who forgives and who seeks his people to come back into relationship with him. And in the life and death of Jesus, we see most clearly the love of God revealed for his people. And God in Christ reveals not only love, but the kind of love that is divine. Think back to one of Jesus' most famous parables, found in Luke's Gospel, the parable of the prodigal son. Here, Jesus plays on the crowd's knowledge of the traditional two-brother stories to tell them a story about a younger son with outstanding gall against an elder son who does as he's bid. A son who disrespects his father so much as to ask for his share of his final inheritance while his father is still alive. He goes off and lives dissolute living, as the Gospel puts it. I always think it's a huge underestimate of what that is. But he lives the wild life. He squanders all that he has, and he is reduced to feeding pigs for a living. A curse that any self-respecting Jew would have gasped at. The son comes to the realization of what he's done. He even prepares a little speech that he's going to say to his father. But before he can, the story turns. And Jesus says, "But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him." And then this reaction is contrasted with that of the bitter elder brother. This is Christ's picture of the love and forgiveness of God. The love that God has for all created people and the forgiveness he offers to all of us. This younger son is your worst nightmare. He's broken all the rules. He has caused about as much offense as he possibly can. And yet, all of that in life is swallowed up, made irrelevant by the love of his father. It is enough for this father, and by implication for God, that he has come home. This parable sums up perfectly the love of God that is revealed in Christ. It's a love of the poorest and the marginalized. It's a love of the outcast and the sinner. It's a love that seeks out the worst and the least, and thereby demonstrate that God loves us all, even us. It's a love that holds no grudges, no ill will, no desire for any kind of payback. We have to pay no price for this love that comes to us from God, it's simply enough that we are here, that we come. It's this kind of overwhelming love and forgiveness, which is almost beyond any description and astonishing in its nature, that Christ demonstrates as he hangs on that cross. It's in the moment of pain, suffering, and injury, with soldiers gambling for his clothes and the crowd jeering on. It's in that moment that Jesus reveals the overpowering love of God by pleading for his murderers. They don't realize what they've done. The point is, the forgiveness of God for Luke is never in question. All that is in question is our return to God. Our return that opens the door for forgiveness and reconciliation to take effect, not only with us and the divine, but in fact with us and other people. John Taylor, in his book, The Christ-like God, writes this. While the forgiving God waits for that return, he pays the price of love in what we can only call pain. Forgiveness does not make light of evil. It knows the sense of outrage, the shock, the shame of injury. But instead of venting it in retaliation or in nursing the grievance, forgiveness owns the wrong that is being done, lives with injury and shame, and by continuing love, turns an evil event into a demonstration of the ultimate good. I think that's a great description of what Christ does on the cross. Through continuing love, an unspeakable evil is turned into good, a good Friday. While God waits in pain, continuing in love, evil is turned around to the victory of good. As people of faith, we have been drawn into this astonishing love of God and shown an example of overwhelming forgiveness. The example of Christ is one which Luke means us to follow, to take forward and live out in our own lives, however difficult that may be. So then, as God in Christ has loved and forgiven us, may we go to love and forgive all those who do us harm, to live somehow with injury and hurt, that evil in this world can be turned around and the passion of God's love experienced by all. Amen. As always today, there's lunch, tea and coffee through in the hall. You're very welcome throughout the service to come and go. And a big thank you to Jamie, who's here to play for us today. I'm delighted to welcome the Reverend David Stewart, who is minister at South Holborn Parish Church, part of the parish grouping, and who has a long connection, as long a connection with Queen's Cross as I do. We were both here when we were young, dark-haired, and slim. David was a youth worker here when I was a probationer. So, a special welcome to you, David.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's nice to be with you on this really special day as we all celebrate together. We're going to begin this little section with the hymn Before the World Began. It's number 317. Let's pray. God of creation, Lord of all, artist of everything that is good, you are might beyond describing. You are more holy than we can ever comprehend. And yet, you are defined not by power nor by glory, but by love. Love lies behind the birthing of the universe. Love lies behind all the days that have passed since Earth's first turn. Love lies behind all that we hope for in the future. And your love hangs today, exposed on the cross. Love in a grand scale to save all of humankind, and love so personal that it speaks forgiveness and comfort to even the worst of us who cries out for you. Yours is love defined by Jesus, who even in the depths of his own pain can still speak words of forgiveness to those who mock him, to those who kill him, to a lost and broken thief hanging at his side. We have no words that are enough to say thank you, Lord, but words are all that we have. And so we say, thank you, Lord. And however we gather today, whatever we hold on to, whatever our mood, whatever our emotions, may we know your love and your forgiveness surrounding us like a holy hug, growing hope and building faith. In Jesus' name, amen. And the first of our readings today in this little section is from 1 Timothy chapter 1, reading verses 15 to 17. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But for that very reason, I received mercy, so that in me as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display the utmost patience, making me an example to those who would come to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. And then we read from Luke chapter 23, verses 35 to 43. And the people stood by, watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he's the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there, kept deriding him, saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? We indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Amen, and may God bless to us his holy word. How can two people see the same thing and come to completely different conclusions? How can two people be witnesses to the same scene and give completely different responses? Of course, we don't just see what's before us. We see through our own experience, our own prejudice, our own way of looking at the world. And so because two people see the same thing does not mean that it means the same thing to them. It happens all the time. Just ask any police officer trying to take a witness statement. And it happened that day on Golgotha. Two criminals, men meeting the fate of their crimes, and neither is happy about it. We don't know their stories. Maybe there's an explanation for the way they turned out. Maybe it's their background. Maybe it's the way they were brought up. Maybe it's the prejudices that they have grown through. We just do not know. We are not told, and we cannot imagine the crimes that they have committed to get to this point in their lives. Only that they are criminals. But they must have been pretty serious criminals to face a death sentence. For their lives are to be taken for the crimes that they have committed. Whatever the reason, here they are. Three crosses on a hill. Two criminals and one other. There's a crowd watching, but it's not gathered for either of the two criminals. In the midst of the crowd, there are some who are in tears, but they're not crying over the two criminals. And then amidst the crowd, there's others, important people who've come to mock and to laugh, but not at either of the criminals. The soldiers too join in with the mocking, having a bit of banter, but it's not directed at either of the criminals. It is the third man who receives the attention, the one with the sign marked King of the Jews. His pain is the cause of the tears of some and the mocking words of others. He saved himself. Saved others. Why can't he save himself? He called himself the Messiah. Look at him now. Even the soldiers join in the mockery when they can be bothered to stop bickering over who gets his meager possessions. The two criminals are two witnesses to the same scene, but they see things so very, very differently. The first, well, maybe he's angry at his lot. I would be. A life that is amounted to a cross. What a waste. Maybe he's bitter. Bitter at being caught. Bitter at being killed. Bitter at the way his life has gone. I probably would be. Maybe he's just so angry and just so afraid and just in so much pain that he wants to lash out. But whatever his reasoning, he joins his voice to that of the mockers. Yeah, mate, if you really are the Messiah, why don't you just save yourself? And you might as well save us while you're at it. For this man, there is only bitterness. There is only anger. There is only darkness. But the other witness, the other criminal, he sees things a bit different. An innocent man, maybe a king, possibly even a savior. But the amazing thing about this criminal is he speaks up and he does the one thing that day that no one else does for Jesus. In this piteous travesty of justice, he dares to do what not another person does that day. He defends Jesus. None of Jesus' followers do. None of his disciples speak up in his defense. But this man, This criminal defends Jesus. Shut up. We're both as guilty as sin. We deserve this, and you know it as well as I. But not him. He is innocent. This criminal sees in Jesus not just a man, but the presence of God. Don't you fear God, he says to his fellow villain. And then to Jesus, he makes a simple request. Remember me when you come to your kingdom. And that's all that's needed for this criminal and for us too. To recognize our own true state, to see our own sinfulness, to recognize who Jesus is, and to ask to be with him. Now, what happens next is barely noticed by the mockers, barely noticed even by the other criminal, but it changes this man's life. Today you will be with me, not on a cross, but in paradise. Max Licato, in his little book, 6 Hours One Friday, describes this scene with these words. Jesus performs the greatest miracle of the cross, greater than the earthquake, greater than the tearing of the temple curtain, greater than the darkness, greater even than the resurrected saints appearing on the streets. Jesus performs the miracle of forgiveness, and a sin-soaked criminal is received by a blood-soaked Savior. Earlier in his ministry, Jesus told a story about a shepherd with 99 sheep who suddenly discovers that his 100th one is missing. So securing the 99, he goes looking for the one that is lost. Well, here he is, the thief on the cross. And as the last sands trickle through the hourglass of his life, he finds hope. He finds forgiveness. He finds life, and he finds light. The lost one is brought back. The prodigal returns. And here on Golgotha, here in that awful place of death, here in that place that will be forever known with horror, here in the blackest place, in the deepest darkness, the light shines. Hope is born. The kingdom grows by one. Today you will be with me in paradise. And even in that last hour of his life, Jesus shows us once more the whole reason for the cross, the whole point behind what happens that dreadful day when the Savior dies. He gives his all to take sins away, and no one is beyond his love. And it's never too late, while there's breath in your body, to hear those words, "You will be with me in paradise." Amen.
We sing together hymn 385, Here Hangs a Man Discarded. Let us pray. O God, how can you have such compassion? Such compassion for people who scorn, for people who willfully ignore, for those who care not, and for those who cause harm and hurt and injury to others, as well as to you. How on a cross can you have such compassion and still find room for love on sight of your mother, in sight of your brother? Lord, teach us to have compassion and take us into your care with your compassion, that even amidst the disappointments and hurts of life, we might value those who love us deeply. that we might love our mothers and fathers, or those in life who have shown us care, attention, and compassion, even when we did not deserve it. Teach us to value our neighbors, be they friend or stranger, to see in them the light of your love. And even when we are caught up in our own problems and woes of life, help us to see the needs of others, that we might reach out in love. Amen. Glad to welcome Robert from Rubislaw.
Well, good afternoon. It is wonderful to be here with you. Thank you, Scott, once again for the invite. Let's listen together now for the Word of God. First reading from the letter to the church at Philippi in chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. And there we hear these words. If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or deceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And then we hear these words from John's Gospel, in the 19th chapter, verses 23 to 27. When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. And so they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what Scripture says. They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots. And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. And when Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." And then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. The grass withers, the flower fades away, but the word of our Lord shall remain forever. Woman, behold thy son. Son, behold thy mother. A unique feature of John's gospel, and to be honest, one I've always felt a bit odd, even uncomfortable, I think, with, is that we're never told Mary's name. We depend on the other Gospels for that. John refers to her only as the mother of Jesus. That is also how he referred to her in the only other place in John's gospel where she appeared, and that was at the wedding feast in Cana of Galilee, the first recorded miracle of Jesus. And both in Cana and here at the foot of the cross, Jesus called to his mother by saying, "Woman," not mother, but woman. In Cana, he asked, "Woman, what have I to do with thee? My hour is not yet come." But by the time of Good Friday, that festive wedding event must have seemed long, long in the past. In Cana, Jesus' hour had not yet come. But now, hanging on that cross, it was that very hour. The hour of truth. The very reason for which Jesus was sent. And so as he hung there on the cross, he discharged his final responsibility to care for his mother. For his mother, yes, but also to care for those of his followers he was leaving behind. And so to his mother, once again, he said, "Woman, behold thy son." And to the disciple, "Behold thy mother." In his gospel, John seems less concerned with recording how Jesus felt about the things that were happening to him than about what those things meant for the lives of those who followed him. We see less anguish in the person of Jesus depicted in John than in the accounts of the other evangelists, but more descriptions of what the future is going to be like for his followers. Likewise, this exchange, showing a concern about the future well-being of his mother and the community of disciples when he would no longer be present with them. And so ensuring that relationship was one of the last pieces of unfinished business that had to be wrapped up as Jesus faced his final hour. And with that relationship ensured and his death finished, a new period of history began, that of the church. A new community with its members living new kinds of lives, new brothers and new sisters, new parents and children, new relationships arising out of Christ's death and his resurrection. And so the fact then that Jesus' mother's name is not given, nor the name of the beloved disciple, actually opens up a new possibility for the generations of disciples who would follow them. Because you see, in a very important way, their names are your name and my name, all our names, giving us responsibility for one another and the ability to depend on each other. The church that came into being that day is one that manifests God's love and participates in God's work in the world, guided by the ever-present Spirit. It's a divine reality, even if it isn't an ideal one yet. But you know, something very important separates this origin from the origin stories of other communities. And that is the fact that it was brought into being not in a moment of glorious self-revelation, not as a negotiated political settlement, nor even as a utopian dream that somehow came true. It was Christ himself who established the church when he spoke to his mother and disciple, but he called it into being while dying on the cross. The cause of his death was divine love interacting with human sin. The cause of his death was human blindness, the misrecognition of good with evil on the part of those whom he came to save. And the fact that it was the crucified Christ who did the calling, the one who died the death of human sin, undermines any sense at all of religious triumphalism. On the contrary, the church is identified as precisely those who need to be saved because of their own sin, our own sin, which necessitated the cross in the first place. Yes, the church is made up of no one else but sinners. Sinners whom Christ came and died to save. And in that Good Friday time of human violence and human loss, as the human life of Jesus reached its end, a new kind of reality came into being. Us, the church. In between the tears and crying of a grieving mother, herself plumbing the depths of grief, the Lord of life ministered to those whom he called his own, those who he loved, those whom he loves still. And so now, as we picture the nameless faces around the world, those in Ukraine, those in Russia, South America, Europe, Africa, Middle East, China, Asia, wherever they may be, as we look around this place and the faces that we see here, listen to the voice of Jesus saying to you now, behold your brother, behold your sister, and from this hour, take them into your own hearts. Amen.
sing together. I'm delighted to welcome John Watson, locum at St Mark's, but well known to all of us, and he's going to lead us in prayer.
I was very interested in what you were saying at the beginning, Scott, when you spoke about yourself and David. You remembered when you had dark hair. When I came to Aberdeen, I had dark hair as well, and I had hair, but now it has taken off. We're going to pray slightly differently today. I don't know if you've ever heard the words of Jesus in Aramaic. During the times that I visited Israel, I was privileged to be able to go to Bible classes there. And I was taught the Aramaic prayer. Jesus never spoke in Greek or Hebrew. He spoke in Aramaic. And it is that prayer that you're going to hear in a few moments. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, on this Good Friday, when you went to your death, we have gathered here to follow your passion. It hurts us to know that you gave your life for us. We do not deserve it. We will never deserve it. For there is a debt that we have to pay that we can never pay. But we know that, as you said to the criminal hanging on the cross beside you, today you will be with me in paradise. And we live through our Christian life from day to day in the hope that we too, when our time comes, will be with Jesus in paradise. Lord Jesus, it's so comforting to know that you can fully sympathize with us as human beings whenever we might feel abandoned by God. Not only did you take the death that we deserved, but you experienced the separation from God that we deserved as well. Thank you for this assurance. For you said you will never leave us and you will never forsake us. I'll say this prayer slowly so that the words can sink in. Abun de Bashmaya Net Kadash Shamak Tete Malkuthak Newe Te Anak Akayan de Bashmaya Afbara Akman de Sukanan Yamana Hav Lanuma Den Washbook Lankavin Akana Dafhanan Shabukan Lekevin Ulowellen Lanisiana Leyen Atezev Lamin Bisha. Amen.
Our first reading is taken from the 22nd Psalm, reading from verse 1. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me, from the words of my groaning? O my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our ancestors trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not human, scorned by others and despised by the people. All who see me mock at me. They make their mouths at me. They shake their heads. Commit your cause to the Lord. Let him deliver. Let him rescue the one in whom he delights. And turning to the Gospel according to St. Mark, we read in chapter 15 from verse 25. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "Ha ha, you who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he's calling for Elijah." And someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was God's son." There were also some women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, the younger, and of Joseph and Salome. These used to follow him and provided for him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem.
Hanging on the cross and near to death, Jesus cried out these words, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," or my God, why have you forsaken me?" These words of Jesus from the cross must be the most astounding words ever spoken, and the most difficult even for learned theologians to try and understand. As he was dying on the cross, Jesus confirmed the beginning of the prophetic Psalm 22, which Scott read just a moment ago. And the psalmist had expressed similar words centuries before. Why had God abandoned him? Why did his father turn his back on him in his moment of greatest agony? Jesus has made it forever unnecessary for us to ever experience or understand the depths of these words from the cross. But the reality of sin and holiness reveals the reason for that sacrifice. These words reveal the horrific cost of putting away of our sin. And of course, the word forsake means to turn away or withdraw from. So why on earth would God ever do that to his own son? None of us would ever think of doing that to our children, so it is extremely difficult to try and understand why the source of all love would turn away from his own son. And yet, that is exactly what happened on that Friday afternoon. When Jesus quoted Psalm 22, and remember, he knew the scriptures inside out, he was talking about King David. When King David found himself in the situation of being abandoned by God. And Psalm 22 is a messianic psalm. But not only is it a messianic psalm, it is also a lament psalm. And notably classified and unbearable in a situation where the psalmist finds himself, depending completely in God to get him out of the situation that he is in. And so when Jesus cried out these words, he was also calling out his completed dependence upon God and his gratitude for the benevolence of his Father. It was, I believe, that at that very point, Jesus realized the total desperation of humanity and that the burden now placed upon his shoulders was so great that he could not bear it alone. In his life, he had felt pain and suffering physically and emotionally, but he had never known separation like this from his father. And now he was experiencing just that. There was a critical sense in which Jesus felt forsaken by his father at this moment, because God made him who knew no sin to be sin for all of mankind. Jesus was identifying with us as he hung on the cross, and he had to pay the price and feel the wrath of God. And it was Isaiah the prophet who said in Isaiah 53, verse 10, "Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him." And so you see, the cross became a symbol not only of forgiveness and love, but also of healing. In my 3 years as convener of what was called social responsibility then, now Crossreach, I was very privileged to have met a young lady called Christine Gibbs. Christine was actually my secretary for the 3 years that I was convener. And Christine was paraplegic. And Christine had a story to tell, a wonderful story, and she wrote a book about it called Only One Way Up. And the story briefly is about Christine's life. And she was at university in Edinburgh. She was sitting in the cafe one day, and she turned to the girl who was with her and she said, "Call an ambulance. I'm having a cerebral hemorrhage." She could actually feel the hemorrhage in her head. And before the ambulance and the paramedics arrived, she was lying prostrate on the floor, totally unconscious. She was taken to Aberdeen Royal Infirmary, and the surgeons tried to work on her, but she was in a deep coma. The strange thing is that in the time that she was in the coma, she was aware of everything that was going on around her. Her parents were summoned, and the doctors were standing by her bedside saying, "There's no hope for her. She'll just slip away." And this went on for 3 months. And Christine lay in that bed, in that coma. And then one day, she had a vision. She thought she was dying, because she felt her body moving and floating. And she came to this hillside. And she stood on this hillside and she looked up the hill and she saw a cross. And she felt compelled to move towards the cross. And as she moved towards the cross, she became aware that there was somebody on the cross. And she bowed her head because she didn't want to look at the face. And as she neared the cross, she noticed the blood that was draining from the person on the cross. She walked forward and realized at that moment that it was Jesus. And it was Jesus' blood that was dripping down from the cross. And she put her arms around his feet and hugged his feet. And at that moment, she was healed. She came out of the coma. She was still a paraplegic, but she had a beautiful sense of the power of Jesus Christ and his cross. And I used to take Christine with me to healing situations. And she only had to touch people and say a small prayer, and they were healed. Dramatic healings. Some healings that have actually been put on television. It was wonderful to know that she was an instrument of God's love and that love came from the cross. Today you might feel God has forsaken you in a similar way that Jesus felt. But you need to understand this. Sometimes God takes away from a Christian his comfort, his riches, his benevolence, but he never takes away his sustaining presence. Yes, today is Good Friday, but for no other reason do we call it Good Friday than it was on this day that God's plans for the world came into fruition. And that the love he had for his son and for us as an undeserving people was made very clear. Whenever you feel that life is throwing a brick at you, whenever you feel that life is an uphill struggle and you can no longer cope, remember these words of Jesus. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? Amen.
We sing together hymn 537. We do not hope to ease our minds. Let's pray. O God, in the parched suffering of your Son Jesus, he cried out, "I am thirsty." Move us, your people, to hunger and thirst for your righteousness. Kindle our hearts with your divine love, that neither death nor life, nor angels or rulers will be able to separate us from your love. Make us hunger and thirst for justice in the world, for your kingdom to come, and to serve each other willingly through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Delighted to welcome Duncan.
Let's hear the word of God in Psalm 22 from verse 9. Yet it was you who took me from the womb. You kept me safe on my brother's breast, on my mother's breast. On you I was cast from my birth, and since my mother bore me, you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls encircle me, strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me like a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within my breast. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death. For dogs are all around me. A company of evildoers encircles me. My hands and feet have shriveled. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots. Our gospel reading is John chapter 19 from verse 23. When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says. They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots. And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." I'm going to read verse 29. A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. Amen, and may God bless to us the reading and hearing of his word. Well, just before I give my reflection, I just want to express my good wishes to Scott and thank Scott for his friendship over the years. We've enjoyed sharing the joys and sorrows of Aberdeen football team. And other things too, and our Scott God's rich blessing in his move down south. Parting is something in our lives that we experience at different stages, and just a year and a half ago, my father was diagnosed with esophageal cancer. And he had increasing difficulty with digestion, with swallowing, and there was that progress or regress from eating solid food to mushy food to drinking liquid, and at the end just dabs of water on the tongue with one of those wee sponges. Thirst is one of the last things to go before dying, and I thirst are the words that Jesus says from the cross. And on one level, we can think of that as a physical, throat-felt thirst, being parched, dry, dying of thirst, we sometimes say. And this picture, this image of Jesus being thirsty on the cross is in such contrast with the one who said he was the source of life-giving water. For example, in John's Gospel, chapter 7, we read, on the last day of the festival, the great day, while Jesus was standing there, he cried out, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me, and let the one who believes in me drink. As the scripture has said, out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water." And then, of course, John's Gospel, chapter 4, Jesus with the woman at the well. "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." Such a glaring contrast between those passages in the gospel and then Jesus hanging on the cross, saying, "I thirst." It contrasts as well with, if we think of the hymn, a much loved hymn, where we hear the words, "I heard the voice of Jesus say, come unto me and rest. Lay down, thou weary one, lay down thy head upon my breast. I heard the voice of Jesus say, behold, I freely give. The living water, thirsty one, stoop down and drink and live. I came to Jesus and I drank of that life-giving stream. My thirst was quenched, my soul revived, and now I live in him." Yet here Jesus says, "I thirst." Does this cry of thirst express something of that down-to-earthiness of the incarnation, as well, of course, the actual physical thirst he was feeling as he hung on the cross? Jesus is alongside those, I would say, who thirst for more, who are searching, who are seeking, who are longing, who wrestle, who struggle with life, who maybe have goals and ideals that are often frustrated, but they continue to thirst. They continue to seek for those ideals, those visions, to be realized. And I think we have something of that sense there. I could not help reflecting recently when we looked at Rembrandt's painting of the returning son, the return of the prodigal son, of Jesus perhaps actually being the prodigal son. There is the waiting father. There is the elder son who looks askance and aloof and looks judgmental in this painting by Rembrandt. The prodigal son is shorn of any good clothes or finery that he had, and is kneeling with broken sandals and a shorn head, kneeling and looking to the Father. He had left the family. He had been searching for more. And I was also thinking of the Stanley Spencer painting that we saw in the Lent study group, where there is one where it's on the reference, the foxes have dens, the birds have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. That Jesus, in a sense, journeys alongside the wandering prodigal son, the one who has nowhere to lay his head, the one who goes on a costly journey, admittedly for wrong motives, for selfish motives, but nevertheless Jesus journeys alongside that one who is searching. And I see Jesus more easily with the prodigal son in some ways than with the elder son, who represents the religious rulers who feel they have done their bit. Does Jesus not draw alongside those who are thirsty for new experiences? Yes, the prodigal son made some choices that had consequences. Yet, does our Heavenly Father not acknowledge and recognize, accept, and bless that sense of searching, of being on a quest? Indeed, even if we were to consider the fall and Adam and Eve taking of the forbidden fruit, although it was an act of sinful disobedience, it is also an act that leads them onto a journey of discovering, of growing, of developing. And therefore, what I would say is that searching and thirsting, is that not what we are meant to be about? Not just finding, but that we are searching. Can thirst be interpreted as a spiritual quest, a lust for life, a longing for life, expressed through our different roles, our different situations in work, in relationships, in service, in the arts, journeying on with Jesus as pilgrim people of the way, not idolizing a status quo, but continuing to yearn, to long, to thirst? That is maybe a message for us as we go through a time of transition and change with our different churches and the grouping, and a time of discomfort, that we need to continue to be that searching pilgrim people. Jesus also, as we look at him on the cross, thirsts for you and me. Jesus comes alongside the psalmist, expresses thirst. O God, you are my God, earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you, my body longs for you, in a dry and weary land where there is no water. And I want to close with this reading from Malcolm Gweet. I don't know if folks have come across Malcolm Gweet. He's got some beautiful reflective readings on the Psalms and also for different seasons of the Christian year. Oh yes, it would help if I had it. Yeah. This is from one of his books called David's Crown. And it's a reflection on Psalm 22, which we heard earlier, but it's also through the knowledge of Christ. Before he shares with us the golden crown, he comes to share with us the crown of thorns. Our hurts and hates close in and hem him round, mock and humiliate him. All the scorns with which we blaspheme God and one another are concentrated here among the horns of unicorns, the lion's mouths, the slather of our devouring wickedness. He takes it all and turns it into love. He gathers all of us and by atonement makes our peace with God. He speaks to us of mercy even as we pierce him. No one slakes his thirst. I tremble at the mystery, for Christ himself is crying through this psalm to suffer my own dereliction for me. Amen.
We join together in the hymn 405. We sing the praise of him who died. I'm absolutely delighted to welcome, I think, for your first ever, because of COVID and everything else that's been happening with the world, Tanya's first Seven Words from the Cross. Tanya, it's great to have you here.
Thank you. Thanks, Scott. Let's join together in prayer. Loving God, we thank you for being with us in these wandering moments where we stand poised between life and death, filled to the brim with sorrow, filled with thoughts of what has been and what lies before us. We wait here by the cross, carrying our grief, the grief of the betrayer, the grief of the denier, the grief of the crucifiers. We carry the grief of the lost, the heartbroken, the bereft. Upon Jesus was laid the grief of us all, until it is finished. God of the cross, God of dark days and great loss, be with us now as we wait with Jesus. It is finished, but it is not over. God of life and death, of beginnings and endings, Remind us that day follows night and hope replaces despair, and life will conquer death. But for just now, we need to be patient. It is finished, Jesus said, but we wait still. So as we wait, we watch for the hope that defies despair, the life that defies death, and the beginning that defies the end, and the love that defies all. In Jesus' name, amen. Our first reading in this section is from Romans chapter 8, verses 31 to 39. And it's entitled, God's Love in Christ Jesus. Let's listen for the word of God. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for us all, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died. Yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of God? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor heights, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And our gospel reading is simply one verse, John 19, verse 30. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Amen, and thanks be to God for these readings of his word. It is finished. A task completed, a mission accomplished, a challenge met, a promise fulfilled, the end of a human life, God's plan executed. It is finished. That's what he said. It might be finished, but it's not over. Not by a long way. Jesus doesn't surrender or give up or give in to despair. He embraces the cross as his divinely appointed mission, trusting that the one who has commissioned him to give his life will also give it back to him. His life does not merely slip away, nor is it torn from him. Rather, he gives over his spirit, calling to mind his earlier words when he described himself as the good shepherd. In John 10, we hear, "I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them in also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again." The cross in John's Gospel is a moment of supreme victory. The cross as victory. Even 2,000 years later, that's sometimes difficult to grasp or accept. That sometimes suffering can lead to healing, that death is not as powerful as life, that what we see as defeat may be God's means of accomplishing victory. But there it is, Jesus' defiant, triumphant cry that in his cross, everything that God has purposed has come to its intended end. Because in John's gospel, the cross is not Jesus' moment of humiliation or defeat or abandonment, as it may be seen in Mark or Matthew's gospel in particular. But for John, this is the moment of Jesus' greatest glory, his elevation as he achieves his mission for which he was commissioned and sent. With all these things accomplished, Jesus declared, "It is finished." Not a cry of despair or failure, because in John's gospel, for Jesus to say, my God, why have you forsaken me, would be theologically impossible for him. Paul's words to the Romans remind us that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And in Jesus' words, he is acknowledging that even in death, he is with God. It is finished. A declaration that the mission has been completed. The Greek word used is tetelestai. It's a long time since my Greek lessons. I hope that's vaguely right. It means bring it to a close, to complete, to fulfill. It can be translated as finished, but it has much more of a sense of something being accomplished, something being drawn to a fitting conclusion, of achieving its intended purpose. And in short, Jesus is saying that everything he was sent to earth to do has now been completed. Which means that far from Jesus crying out in agony and despair from the cross, he dies with a shout of victory on his lips. Jesus is elevated both physically and metaphorically so that the whole world can see that moment when the giving of the Son is made manifest. In this act, God's love is revealed for the wayward world. Jesus announces that his mission has been completed, and he breathes his last and dies. His hour has come, and he accepts that. He moves on to the next stage. It was done. The agony, the torture, the awful, awful death. But in that, a task was completed, a mission was accomplished, a challenge was met, a promise was fulfilled, a human life ended, but God's plan was executed. It is finished. That's what he said. It might be finished, but it's not over. Not by a long way. Amen.
We join together in the hymn 399. My song is Love Unknown. Let us pray. God of grace and mercy, yours is a love known to us and yet unknown, a love whose depths we cannot possibly understand. a love whose oneness has a mercy beyond our comprehension, a love which endures, a love which forgives, a love which catches us when we fail. It is this love, spent on a cross for us this day, which we remember. And we remember not simply to mourn, but to endure, to find strength in, to find courage from, a love which will survive all things. Lord, reveal this love to us, that we might understand fully your care, your concern, and your compassion for us, that we might place our trust in you above all others. Amen. From Psalm 31, we read these words. In you, O Lord, I seek refuge. Do not let me ever be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. Incline your ear to me. Rescue me speedily. Be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. You are indeed my rock and my fortress. For your name's sake, lead me and guide me. Take me out of the net that is hidden for me, for you are my refuge. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. And from the Gospel, according to St. Luke, we read in chapter 23 from verse 44. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. While the sun's light failed and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, with a loud cry, said, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said, Certainly, this man was innocent. And when all the crowds who had gathered there for this spectacle saw what had taken place, they returned home, beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things. Thanks be to God. One of my favourite things in conducting worship, as anybody who comes to worship here will be able to testify, is baptism, particularly the baptism of infants. There is nothing I love more in my working life than an infant baptism. I love babies. I know I can't help it. I just love babies. I don't mind if they cry. I don't mind anything. I just love holding a little child. There is something so precious, so miraculous and amazing about a young child. And I love the liturgy from the Book of Common Order. It was changed from the last Book of Common Order, which was written in the 70s, to the one we use today, taken from actually the L'Église Réformée, which is the French Reformed Church. That's where the current baptismal liturgy came from. And in that liturgy, there are these words. In baptism, the love of God is offered to each one of us. though we cannot understand it or explain it, we are called to accept that love with the openness and trust of a child. Believing is one thing in life, but faith, and more so trust, is quite another. The baptismal liturgy reminds us that there is something in us as adults that rebels and rails against this idea of simple trust. Be that the simple trust of faith, or indeed the simple trust of other people. Is that because trust involves a loss of control toward your own fate? Does trust sometimes seem to us like putting ourselves into the hands of something else, someone else, with no way really of knowing where that other will take us? It's a vulnerable thing to do. Simple faith, simple trust. And I think as humans, as adults, it is surely a loss of control of our own destiny and journey in life that we fear the most. And you see that from people's experience at lots of different stages in their lives, whether it's infirmity, adolescence. The realization that we can't control everything is hard. And while a small baby has no choice but to be thrust into the hands and the care of adults, and indeed has no life experience to imagine that anything untoward could possibly happen, after 50 years of living, that kind of naivety about the world has long since disappeared. There is something, I think, both profound and difficult about that exhortation to accept the love of God with the openness and trust of a child. I think as we grow older, it can become more difficult to trust as a child trusts. To entrust oneself to others, even to entrust in your mind your own life to the care of God, to think that in some way your life is not your own and another hand is at play. Despite his week of passion, the pain, suffering, and human experience of his end, in Luke's gospel, Jesus on the cross finishes with a word of trust in God, a word taken from the prayer book of the Psalms, there in Psalm 31. Into your hand I commend my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. It shouldn't really surprise us that Luke would say such a thing, because Luke is writing theology, not necessarily literal history. And Luke gives us a picture of a Jesus who is totally dependent on his Father, who totally and completely trusts him, and who is determined to see his work through to the very end. Having finished the work he was sent to do, he trusts his Father with the final journey we all make. He hands himself over to God in complete trust. He is ready to be received. Despite the horrific events of his last hours, Luke's Jesus is marked by this complete and prayerful trust, not a sort of unfeeling, pious trust, but simply the trust of a man whose whole hope and faith lies in the God whom he believes to be his Father. And Jesus hands himself over in complete trust, as that baptismal liturgy puts it, with the openness and the trust of a child. How is such a trust possible? That classic writer in the area of Christian spirituality, Henri Nouwen, relates a story about the nature of this trust in a book entitled Our Greatest Gift. He tells of a conversation he held with a man named Rodley. Rodley was the leader of a troupe of trapeze artists whom he'd seen, who Nouwen had seen perform at the circus in Freiburg. And when he saw their trapeze act, he was enraptured by it. It was for Nouwen the way that they moved through the air, flying and catching as elegant as dancers. Nouwen became friendly with the troupe and he quizzed Rodley, who himself was a catcher in the troupe, about this great skill. Rodley said, As a flyer, I must have complete trust in my catcher. The public might think that I am the greatest star of the trapeze, but the real star is Joe. He is my catcher. He has to be there for me with split-second precision and grab me out of the air as I come to him in the long jump. How does it work? Nouwen asked. The secret, Rodley replied, is that the flyer does nothing and the catcher does everything. When I fly to Joe, I simply have to stretch out my arms and my hands and wait for him to catch me and pull me safely over the apron behind the catch bar. You do nothing? Nouwen said, surprised. Nothing. Absolutely nothing, Rodley repeated. The worst thing a flyer can do is to try and catch. I am not supposed to catch Joe. It's Joe's job to catch me. If I grab Joe's wrists, I might break them, or he might break mine, and that would be the end for both of us. As a flyer, I must fly, and a catcher must catch. And the flyer must trust with outstretched arms that his catcher will be there for him. What a fabulous analogy for all of our lives. As flyers, we must fly. And as flyers, we must trust with outstretched arms that our catcher will be there for us. Friends, all we can do, the best and the only thing that any of us can do in life, is fly. Fly as we know how best to do. Change is difficult, and I'm about to undertake a huge change for me personally, for Dave, and I know for many of you too. And it's difficult to know why you would bring change to your life when everything's comfortable and everything's happy and everything's grand, except to say there is this odd thing that goes on in our lives called the call of God. There is this odd impetus for a change. And even when it looks difficult and even when you can't fully understand it or you can't explain it, it doesn't take that impetus away. It's something that calls out. And for each of us, in every part of our lives, you'll know there has been change, or there has been something maybe brought about to you, or a point when you've decided or come to a place of knowing, feeling that something has to be different. And there's that moment of reaching out, of not knowing, of worrying, of anxiety about what can come next and whether this is a moment of madness or a moment of truth. In every part of our life, and at whatever stage we are in our lives, whatever the transition is that comes to us in our lives, flyers must fly. And as flyers, at some point, we have to trust God and accept faith as that act of trust with the openness of a child. Good Friday, in the words from the cross, sees a journey through gloom, suffering, all the different emotions of the day, and indeed life itself. God crucified on his cross, not only on that one day, not only on that one occasion, but all the days when we fail to live, to fly, when we fail to live justly, when we fail to share equitably, when we fail to walk peacefully and to give our love freely one to another. And yet, despite all that, the final word from Luke is one of trust in God, a God whose love for us surpasses all our weaknesses and our failings. The final words of Jesus should be a great encouragement to all of us who simply try our best at flying. Hey, we may not always fly greatly. We may not always fly with great grace. Rather than soaring on eagle's wings, often it feels, doesn't it, as if we have to flap around at great pace, like a wee sparrow, just simply to keep up in the air. No matter. When the psalmist says, "The Lord is my rock and my stronghold," maybe he means the same, that no matter how poorly we fly at the end, we know we have the greatest of catchers. That knowledge, that faith, that trust is surely what lies in those words of Jesus. "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." That faith and trust lies at the very heart of Luke's gospel and the good news of Jesus Christ himself. God's love is larger than our failings. God's forgiveness is greater than all of our letdowns. Thank goodness God's grace catches us all. So we can leave here, yes, with the tragedy of the day in mind, teaching us the lessons about life that we need to learn. But hopefully too, we leave this place today emboldened. Emboldened simply to fly, not to worry about it, not to be anxious about it all the time, but simply to fly. Determined to try and fly as best as we know how. To try and fly as best we can in Christ's way. But remembering in the end, there is God. God who is the greatest catcher of all time. Amen. I want to say before we close, thank you. Thank you to my colleagues who have taken time out of a busy week to contribute so grandly to today's service. I want to say thanks to Jamie, who is here and played marvelously for us. Jamie is not only a terrific organist, he is about to start ministry as a priest in the Scottish Episcopal Church, but working, I think, in the Church of Scotland. So a paragon of ecumenism. Well done. I want to say thank you to the ladies who are all, well, some of them here, but also back through in the kitchen and busy. They are the Marthas of our churches, and they do a grand job providing us lunch. And I think there will be, even after we finish, there'll still be tea, coffee, and a few fine pieces if you're interested to eat up. I want to say thanks too to the two Davids on AV who have taken our service out to that mystery called the World Wide Web. And thanks to you for taking your time on this Good Friday to join together for worship, for prayer, and for reflection. We close with the hymn 386, Lifted High on Your Cross. Go then on your way on this Good Friday. Go and fly. Fly as you will, fly where you can, knowing that you have the greatest catcher of all time. And may the grace of this Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the company of the Holy Spirit be with you and all of God's people this day and forevermore. Amen.